In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, amen. So just before we start the sermon, let's just pick off where we left off in terms of the explanation of the liturgy, and then we'll get into the sermon right away. So again, if we missed any of these, you can just find them on our website under that icon. So again, in general, if we want to kind of have a very, very big picture of the liturgy, we can divide it into three major parts: the preparation, the liturgy of the word, and the liturgy of the faithful. So the preparation is what we do the day before, which is what we call Vespers, or the evening raising of incense, and the morning of. So we don't just jump into the liturgy. We actually prepare ourselves, and that's teaching us really to be prepared as well. So coming in, our Saturday nights count, our Sunday mornings count. So what we do, like, we should prepare, ease ourselves, ease our bodies, ease our spirits into basically coming into the liturgy. Then we have the liturgy of the word, which we just finished, which we receive the word of God through all the different epistles, the gospel, and then the sermon. And then we start the liturgy of the faithful, which is the conclusion of that is Holy Communion. So the liturgy of the faithful starts with the three great litanies, as opposed to, you know, when we call them the seven small litanies that we say. So as you saw last week, we did it audibly, and they're much bigger, but they're kind of, again, still praying for the same things, but we add quite a few words for those, for the peace of the church, the fathers, the assemblies. Then we pray the prayer of reconciliation so that we make sure that we are at peace with one another, peace with God, and peace even within ourselves. Then we are ready to lift up our hearts, the anaphora, lift up our hearts to sing and to be joining the ongoing liturgy that is going on in heaven at all times, right? And that's why we are with all the ranks of the angels. Then we have the holy, holy, holy part, the whole story of salvation, reminding us of what happened from the garden all the way to his resurrection and ascension. The institution narrative is where we ask the Holy Spirit to come upon the bread and wine to make it his body and blood. Then we have the seven litanies or seven prayers that are a little bit short that we pray for different things. And then the next part is the commemoration of saints. So we just want to know who are the saints that we are commemorating. So we're going one by one. And this week we are on St. Peter. St. Peter, so last couple of weeks we did a couple of patriarchs. And then we have another patriarch. This one is number 100, and this one is number 17, and we call him St. Peter, the seal of martyrs. So if you look below, it says he became a patriarch in the year 285 AD. So if we know our Coptic history a little bit, right, we know 284 is a big year, right? 284 is when we start our Coptic calendar, and that is the start of the reign of Diocletian. So the start of reign of Diocletian, who is the emperor that killed the most martyrs. It is estimated it's 800,000 martyrs in an 11-year stretch that he did. So we start our Coptic year, and so he was the patriarch during that time. So just kind of like putting our time in terms of that. So at the age of seven, he was given to the pope before him, Pope Theonas. So Pope Theonas basically saw him, and he ordained him as a reader, you know, like a deacon, a reader, a full deacon, and then finally a priest. And he said that this person is going to be the next patriarch after me. He prophesied or felt that this person was going to be the one that was going to be. We call him the seal of martyrs, because he was basically at the end of the reign of Diocletian, and he was martyred as a patriarch, again, kind of joining the 800,000 that were with them. But that was the end of the reign of Diocletian, and that was the end of the great, great persecution and martyrdom of the church at that time. Maybe one thing he's very known, I mean, it kind of happened in his time, that just a very interesting story of a woman who really, her husband wasn't a faithful Christian, and she had two children, and she really, really, really wanted to baptize her children. So she did not live in Alexandria, so she took a boat and she sailed to Alexandria, hoping to get to a church and somebody to baptize her children. On the way, there was a huge storm, and she felt that they were gonna die, and she was afraid that their kids are gonna die without being baptized. So what she did is she baptized them. She baptized them in an emergency. So thank God they actually ended up landing and they went afloat, they landed on the ground. And then okay, we made it, so let's go baptize my kids. And she went to this Pope Peter, and Pope Peter prepared everything. And every time he was about to baptize the child, the water froze. So he wanted to submerge the child into the baptismal font, but every time it froze. And he tried this a few times, and he said, okay, what's going on here, lady? He goes, well, I was in the middle of the seat. I didn't know what to do, and I didn't want my kids to be baptized, so I baptized them. And he said, this proves what we read in St. Paul, right, and this what we believe in our church, that there is one baptism. So that baptism of the mother was accepted before the Lord, therefore there's no need for another baptism. So that was an interesting story that happened during the reign of St. Peter, the Seal of Martyrs.